And Newsweek has written this story on in October of year 2002, in which it mentions that when some Russian soldiers raided a Muslim house which only had civilians inside the house, they basically started shooting at everyone that day. For my sisters, for my brothers, for my children, it was a very long day. But not only this, to their horror, before my mother gave her life in front of these soldiers, she saw that one of these brutal soldiers started raping one girl who was actually dying on the ground. Started raping a sister who was dying on the ground. And after he raped her, a second soldier came and he said to the first soldier, whose name was Kolya, that, oh, hurry up, let me have my chance while she is still warm. This day was very, very long. This day was very, very long for my brothers and sisters, for my children who saw in front of their own eyes that their own sisters and mothers were raped in front of the Ummah of 1 billion. But it does not end here. When we continue, we see that in Iraq, it was 10:30 in the night on the June of the 26th in year 2003, when the invasion has happened, when Iraq is in crisis, and Muhammad al-Kubaisi, 12 years old, tells his mother, Mother, I am very, very hot. There is no air conditioning in this house. Let me climb onto the roof so that I may receive some shade. His mother tells him, My son, go upstairs. He goes with his twin brother, Mustafa. He climbs onto the roof. And when he reaches the roof, he looks down. And suddenly, to the horror of his mother, one single shot explodes from below the ground. And Muhammad is lying in a pool of blood. That night for Muhammad's mother was very, very long when she dragged Muhammad inside and she screamed, and this happened to my son. What has happened to the flower of my heart? She held him. He was bleeding. He could not speak. She took him downstairs. Before she could take him out, the door was broken down and American patrols came in and they said, where is the firing from? And she told them that this was the firing which happened from outside. My son is injured. Their neighbor actually volunteered to take Muhammad to save his life. It was only to their sorrow, only to their horror, that when they reached the first checkpoint in Baghdad, that the Americans turned them back, that there is a curfew here. Muhammad bled to his death by the morning. That day and that night was very, very long for my brother. For my mother, it was equivalent to 100 years maybe. That night she will never forget. And I have the cuttings of interviews which you can read of how she felt on that night. When we go to the final country which has suffered for 60 years or more, Palestine, the land of the Anbiya, the land of the Awliya, the land of Masjid al-Aqsa, which cries every day and every night, which weeps upon the Ummah, which was given the title of the best of the Ummah, but yet today we are in disgrace. We travel there and we see what the people there are sacrificing, the people whom we taunt, the people whom we blame for the misfortune which has befallen on this Ummah. We see that on October the 5th, Iman wakes up in the morning. She's a 10-year-old girl. She tells her mother, Mom, I am going to school. Maybe she's thinking in her mind that maybe I will be able to study something. Maybe I will be able to bring some livelihood back to my suffering family. She leaves in the morning. She travels and she goes to school. She is sitting in a school which belongs to the United Nations. And suddenly, before reaching the school, she goes through a tower block which is guarded by the Israelis. And suddenly, to the horror of her mother, who was not there, but the world media reports this incident, suddenly a shot is fired from the tower which hits her leg. She falls down wounded, and the second shot is fired again at her second leg. She falls down, she is nearly unconscious now, and to the horror of the world, and the shame to the civilization of the 21st century, I swear by Allah, and this is in the Western media, 17 bullets were pumped into her head. Is this the civilization of this world today? 17 bullets were pierced into her head. When her body was picked up, 20 bullets were in her head. That day for my mother was very, very long. She will not forget that day when Iman, her sweetheart, her part of her body was brought home with 20 bullets in her body. How can the Ummah be forgiven for such a crime? But this is not only the case in Palestine. When we go further, we will see that this same Ummah has witnessed the Al-Huda Darwish, who went to school in Palestine at the age of 11. She reaches the school. She is sitting in school and suddenly the siren starts sounding. Suddenly bullets start flying, and to her horror, suddenly one bullet hits Darwish in hits Al-Huda in her head, and before she knows it, on, and this is on March, in March of year 2003, she's taken to hospital, she is in a coma. For 3 weeks, her mom waits outside the intensive care unit, praying to Allah, that Allah save my child's life. This is a child, just like you have your child, just like I have children, she also has a child. She's praying to Allah, oh Allah, save my child. After 3 weeks, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her conscious. She wakes up from her sleep. She goes there, and I have seen this with my own eyes. When she goes and she kisses Al-Huda, and she says, Al-Huda, the doctors tell her, after 3 weeks in coma, she has awakened now. She asks her mother, Mother, why are all the lights switched off? Her mother tells her, the electricity has failed in Gaza. Only to her horror, the doctors tell her that the bullet which penetrated through her head has blinded her for the rest of her life. What future does she hold? And for what crime and for what sin was this girl blinded forever?